Good morning. And happy Sunday morning to each and every one of you. Amen. Amen. I am always so happy to see your smiling faces each and every Sunday morning. And certainly, we welcome the Holy Spirit's presence in this place. He is such a good and gracious God, and He loves us more than we could imagine, you all. He touched us this morning and gave us one more chance to be in His house of praise and worship. I just praise God for being who He is. He is so good, so kind, so gracious, and I am excited. Now, you all may note that I'm doing double and triple duty. So if you see me moving around and it looks a little strange, for those of you at home as well, I am running the pulpit and the IT and the live stream all at the same time. So let's see how it goes, amen? Check number one, make sure we're streaming. We are. Amen, amen. So praise God for little successes. I have been practicing how to do this by myself just in case. And so I am just so thankful to God that we have worked it out so that if nobody shows up there, I can do it myself. Adam, his full-time job is in the IT world, and he's doing some big conference out of state this weekend and couldn't be here. And Terry is very much so under the weather. And I just need you all to keep her in prayer. Certainly, I may or may not, since I'm talking about it now, bring it up during Joys and Concerns. I took Terry to the emergency Friday, and we were there till, I don't know, 1 a.m. or later. And they let her go home, and they shouldn't have. And then yesterday, I still came in and did the worship service on Saturday. She did show up. I don't know how, but she showed up. But I was able to run the service myself from my laptop so that she didn't have to work yesterday. But she was sick even in service. And so certainly she was not feeling up to coming out this morning. I kind of figured as much. So I will run the IT from the floor as they have trained me to do. What I will say is please keep her in your prayers. Please do that. She is extremely sick, and so we just really, really need to be prayerful. And I said yesterday in worship service, one day you all are going to listen to me, because I kept saying whenever someone gets busy around here, they get sick. Something happens in their lives. It comes up against them. And I keep saying, please pray for one another. Please do that. Satan is determined to keep ministry from going forward, and he'll do whatever he can to keep that from happening. I just praise God that on today, as of 10:36, he has lost that battle, because we are streaming so that those that are unable to be in the midst are still able to hear a word from the Lord. And so I certainly praise God for that. So you may not see all the fancy stuff that you normally see, but certainly we will be blessed nonetheless. This morning's inspirational scripture comes from the 138th number of Psalm, Psalm number 138 and verse 8. And it reads, "The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the work of your hands." And let me just read that again. "The Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. Do not forsake the work of your hands. And I just praise God because when I hear and read that particular scripture text, it encourages me that everything he has called me to do, everything he has called each of you to do, it will come to pass. We need to quit listening to Satan. Whatever he has deemed for you to do, God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit will bring it to pass. And I just praise God for that because I know the calling he's placed on my life. But I also know that Satan is determined to whisper in my ear every chance he gets that it's not going to happen. But here, this word encourages us. He will fulfill the purpose for me. And I love that because it's a personal word. So you all need to point it to yourselves and say, for me, because that is what he is going to do. He is going to fulfill his purpose for you because he loves us. And his love endures forever. It is steadfast. It'll never stop. It'll always continue. And when people look at us, they're going to see the blessings of God. So when this scripture says, do not forsake the work of your hands, I am the work of his hands. You are the work of his hands. And our prayer is that indeed, when others look at us, they will see the joy of the Lord. Amen. 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 So today's inspirational message of sorts for me. Take that home with you on today. For me. Amen. Amen. Please stand with me and let us pray our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. For those of you in the sanctuary, as well as those of you at home, as always, you are welcome in this place.
Welcome to church.
We are so glad that you're here.
And we want you to know that when you walk through our doors today,
you didn't just walk into a building.
You walked into a family.
And regardless of who you are,
where you came from,
or what you look like,
you are welcome here.
Because at this church, we believe that God is love.
And that he is in the business of rekindling lost passions,
restoring broken dreams,
and filling empty lives.
At this church, we believe that life in Christ is not a formula of rules and laws,
but a moment-by-moment relationship with Jesus.
And his love is infinite and everlasting,
without pretense or conditions or discrimination.
At this church, we can't stand religion,
but we love God.
And if you're not quite sure what the difference is yet,
we can't wait to show you.
We're glad you joined us today.
Welcome to church.
Amen. Welcome to church. Amen. Amen. We do have a few announcements for this morning. Please commit these to memory as they will not show up on the wall for today. The month of October is the month that we collect for our World Mission Offering. Now, you all that have been members here over the years know that four times a year we take up special offerings. We have been off of our schedule for probably at least a full year now. And the reason is because we quit receiving the promotional materials that would normally come to remind us that we needed to do one particular giving or another. I'm thankful for Dick Potter, who is still diligently working in this ministry, even though you don't see him week to week, for always reminding and always sending our gifts to these varied offerings, special offerings that we give. And so we want to try to get ourselves back on schedule. So although I haven't seen the actual materials with the envelopes that we're used to receiving, certainly October is the month that we collect for the World Mission Offering. I would ask you all that if you give electronically, of course, you are welcome to just click on World Mission Offering. It is a selection that is there. For those of you that don't give electronically, I would just ask that throughout the month of October that you would just note it on your envelopes what it is you're giving to World Mission Offering. I thought that I had this fixed and that all envelopes were coming in, and so I will reach out again to make sure that the offering envelopes and promotional materials for our special offerings are being sent and received. So that's the World Mission Offering for October. This coming November, we're getting out ahead of it. We are going to have what I'm starting to now call our annual Family and Friends Day. I had such a good time last year when we did our Family and Friends Day and thought it would just be prudent to do it again. It gave us a chance to see some people that we hadn't seen. It gave us a chance to invite some family members who don't usually come and to share in worship with us. So it will be November 12th. I believe that is the second or third Sunday in November. Quick to find out. Second, that is the second Sunday in November. And so I will talk about it more as we get closer to that date. Certainly, we will be recognizing whoever brings the most people. So get out here and start shaking the trees and rattling the cages and get people prepared to come share in worship service with us the second Sunday of November. That is November 12th. Amen. We plan to have some light refreshments after service. It won't be a full meal, but just some sort of light refreshments that we might be able to fellowship with one another. Amen. We still have our Saturday praise and worship services at 3:00, and we are continuing to pray and praise God for church successes. I know that I saw a few in the paper over the past week, and so I would turn your attention even to yesterday's paper. There were some news stories about churches that are having particular successes, that are holding different types of giving and festivals, and certainly we want to keep those churches in our prayers, and we want to thank God for their ministry. Because one thing we are coming to know is that if we thank God for someone else's blessing, He certainly will be open to blessing us. And when you're selfish and you only think of yourself, you're cutting off your blessings. So as we go through whatever we're going through and praying for whatever we're praying for, if you see someone being blessed with that thing, praise God with them for the blessing. Amen. Amen. This month, it's a new month. Our giving for AVAC is boxes of stuffing. Boxes of stuffing. And so my prayer is that we would bring box stuffing in as we prepare and head into the Thanksgiving Day holiday. At home, you all that are at home, do know that you can give as well. Bring your boxes of stuffing here to the church or give financially, and we'll go out and make those purchases for you. Our goal here at First Baptist Tarentum is to just help one, because we recognize that when we help one, we absolutely position ourselves to help many. Amen. And amen. Please join me in the singing of our first musical selection.
is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name.
This is true.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love, and through the storm, He is Lord, He's Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy
Christ alone.
That song absolutely reminds me of Terry Fox. I just can't help it. It is now time for our responsive reading. Today's responsive reading is number 667. Oh, come on, you can. Yay! Amen. Look at that deacon moving. Amen. Number 667. And turn it on, push it up. Like on the side, there's a little button, push up. There you go. Do it again. Hit it again. Hit it again, Shirley.
They can hear me.
They can hear you. I'm gonna come help you.
To be pitied.
But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep.
For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead.
For as in Adam all died, so also in Christ shall all be made alive.
Someone will ask, how are the dead raised? What kind of life do they come?
You foolish man, what you sow does not come to life from the blessing of God.
And what you sow is not the body which is to be, but a bare kernel, perhaps of wheat or of some other grain.
But God gives it a body in which he has chosen, and in each time he sees his sown.
So it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown is perishable, what is raised is imperishable.
It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory, it is sown in weakness, it is raised in power.
It is sown a physical body, it is raised a spiritual body. If there is a spiritual body, there is also a spiritual body.
For this perishable nature was put on the imperishable. And this mortal nature was put on the immortality.
When the perishable puts on the imperishable, and the mortal puts on immortality, then shall come to pass the saying that is written,
death and slaughter and victory. O death, where is thy victory? O death, where is thy sting?
The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord.
Thank you so much, Shirley. We appreciate you stepping in and giving me a chance to find the hymn. Amen. We praise God for the reading and the hearing of his holy and righteous word. It is now time for our offertory period. For those of you in the sanctuary, trays, a tray certainly will be passed for you. You're welcome to give in the midst of this sanctuary. For those of you that are at home, as well as those in the sanctuary, if your preference is to give electronically, certainly we have that electronic giving forum, tithe.lee.com, available for you to give to First Baptist Church of Tarentum. We certainly appreciate all gifts that are given. This morning's offertory hymn, number 366 in your hymnals, number 366 in your hymnals, I Surrender All. And please stand with me, if you would, as we sing our offertory Him. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we come before you right now, Lord, thanking you for every gift that has been given in this place and abroad. Heavenly Father, we pray right now in the name of Jesus that your work would be able to be done, that we would move with wisdom in our hearts and minds. Heavenly Father, that we would do what you are directing us to do, that we would be a service to our community, Lord, and that indeed we would be a shining light in this Allegheny Valley. Oh, Lord, we thank you right now in the name of Jesus and pray that all of these gifts will be multiplied in the lives of these your givers. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen. 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 It is now time for our joys and concerns. Okay, you're going to have to use your outside voices when you give your joys and your concerns this morning. So let me walk through the list that we have put together this past week. We're praying for Tracy Black, who is traveling in Ireland alone, that she would have safe passage. We're continuing to pray for Stephen, who is battling cancer. We're praying for Jesse Cadwell, who is a church member of my mom's who has been sick and is not eating. And certainly it is not good when a person stops eating. And we're praying for Laura Ross, my step-grandmother who had cataract surgery recently. Man, I'm all over the top. We're praying for the Daniel family, which is my mother's last name, the Daniel family in the loss of her stepson, my brother, Chuck Charles, my stepfather, the father that raised me, namesake, passed away this past week. And so we're certainly as a family being prayerful. I'm not going to be able to make it home for the funeral in that they're doing the funeral on a Tuesday. and my commitments here require me to be available on Tuesday, so I won't be able to go home for the funeral. But certainly I'm sending my condolences to our entire family, and know that many of us have made it to town to be there in the funeralization of my brother. His father is the only father I knew until I was almost 40. And so certainly we are not step brothers and sisters. He is just as much my brother as the brother my mother birthed. And so certainly we're praying for the family. We are praying for Shane and his family. We were asking your prayers on last week for a friend of Todd's mother. His mother had the surgery, and we listed it as a joy last week that she made it through that surgery, but she did succumb to her illness over the course of the week, and so we're praying for that family, Shane and his entire family. We're continuing to pray for Terry Fox. He was released from the hospital last week, but still is undergoing some tests, and certainly we are continuing to keep him in prayer. We're praying for Edwina Ivy, who's having some life challenges, for Peggy Klink and the entire Klink family. Please let's not forget them. Often when the funeral is said and done, we move on, and the people that are dealing with that grief are still wrestling. And so we need to keep them in our prayers, as well as Pat, who's coming up on that anniversary, as well as Brock, who's absolutely coming up on that anniversary. We are close, you guys. Please know that as much as I stand before you and do what I do, I absolutely am not okay. So hear that from the pastor directly. I am not okay. This is the period of time when by now I had taken him back to the emergency. He got out of the hospital that last Sunday. It would have been a week ago that he got out of the hospital. And so by now, I would have taken him back, and that would be his last time in the hospital. And then he came home on hospice a matter of days later. So certainly October 17th is quickly approaching. So just whisper my name anytime you think about it. I certainly stand in the need of prayer. I don't know if this second anniversary is worse than the first. I mean, people say it gets, the second one is harder. I don't know. It's all hard. You know, most days I'm doing just fine, but yeah, you know, knowing that every day is a reminder right now of what Dennis went through, what he was going through, and what we were doing as a family. So certainly keep me and everyone who loved Dennis in your prayers. And I'm taking my time, it's gonna be okay. We're gonna be long because of communion anyway. My mother texted me this week, this past week, sharing that she is wrestling as well. She loved Dennis like he was one of hers. And she leaned on him for every little thing. You know, she would call him about the car, call him about the house, call him. And so she certainly is feeling it as well. And she let me know that during the week. And so I told her, I said, well, Mom, I have asked in the Bible class and in our prayer on Thursdays for the people to pray for me and the entire family. And so I say again, all of us, I'm sure his sisters and brothers, his kids, are just experiencing that grief at such a high level right now, because I would have called for his kids by now when he was in the next day or two. I called for his children to come to town so that they could have a final goodbye with him. So it was just not a good time of year for us. So please keep us in prayer. Don't feel sorry for me. Pray for me, because death is a part of life. And I'm not the only one in this room who has lost a husband, a brother, sister, mother, father. And so I get it. So I don't want your pity, I want your prayers. Because it's okay. Huh, what choice do you have but to be okay? So yeah, keep me in your prayers. We're praying for Gloria Palmer. We have a Joy, Jalen, and the kids, and Corey. The storm went through there, knocked the tree down. It didn't completely destroy the house, so we're joyful. We're praying for Craig. We're praying, and our prayers worked, that there wouldn't be a government shutdown. We're praying for Mary, Craig's friend. We're praying for the missing. We're continuing to pray for Chet Howe, John Rizak, Dick and Valerie Potter. Let's keep all of those individuals in our prayers. Okay, that's my long list for this morning. Who would you all like to pray for? Yes, Pat. Oh, so sorry. Certainly, we will be praying for you all. Yes. What? Craig, you let that birthday slip up on us? Let's sing one verse, a happy birthday to Craig. Somebody got to start it other than me. Y'all know I can't sing. Amen, Craig. Happy birthday to you. Any others? Yes. Yes, Judy, we got you. Any others? Yes, Cindy. The who in her family? What's her relation to them? Okay. All right. We'll certainly pray for her family who are suffering as a result of her passing. Debbie.
First, I'm going to express my condolences on the ones who brought her family.
Thank you.
Yeah. And I'm so glad you're here. And I want to thank you for the prayers for my cat. Everything's great. Second was done. And Tim was sick for a while. We think it was a tick bite.
Amen. Amen. That really is a joy. Certainly, we praise God for their safety. Amen. We don't take that lightly. That truly is a joy and something to say thank you for. Amen. Any others? Circling. You want to try your joke? You're going to use your outside voice? Only we can hear you in here. The people at home can't hear you.
So much about death reminds me of a tombstone in England. Maybe you're about to name it from England. Might say that it said, "Under this sky and under these trees lies the remains of Solomon Pease. Pease is not here, and only his pot. Pease has shelled out and gone home to God."
Amen.
This pastor seen this group of small boys in a circle, and he walked over, "What's up, boys?" And they had a dog in the middle, and they said, "Well, we're saying who can tell the biggest lie. Whoever tells the biggest lie gets to feed the dog." And he just completely rattled him. He gave him a 10-minute sermon on the ills of lying. And he ended it by saying, "When I was your boy's age,
Thank you. Let's add Craig Fullerton to our list as well this morning. All right, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, first of all, for all of the joys that we have experienced, for all of your answered prayers. We say thank you. Heavenly Father, for the Zelsman grandchildren to make it through the car accident safely, we say thank you. Heavenly Father, for Terry Fox being on the mend, we prayerfully say thank you. For Jaylen, Corey, the kids not to suffer any true damage to their home in the wakes of the tropical storm that hit the Carolinas, we say thank you. And in Heavenly Father, we know that there are many other joys that didn't get mentioned in this place on today. And for those, we also say thank you. Heavenly Father, we pray for all those who are grieving right now, grieving the loss of any person, place, thing, we pray for them. And Heavenly Father, we pray that your Holy Spirit would continue to be a comfort for them, lifting them up when they're feeling down. Heavenly Father, keeping them moving forward and going in spite of all that they're facing. And then Heavenly Father, we pray for the sick. Heavenly Father, there are many among us who are just not well. And so we pray for healing on this morning. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would touch in the way that only you can. And in Heavenly Father, who we pray for those unspoken that have been offered up in this place on today. And we know that there's more than just one. And we pray that you would touch in their lives. Lord, bless and touch the missing, that they might indeed have a strong relationship with you. We certainly welcome them back here, but Lord, move them that they might be under the leadership, the tutelage, the prayers of some pastor. Lord, we know that you can do it all, and we trust you in the here and the now for it. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen. 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 It is now time for another musical selection. So please join me as we sing praises to the King.
Abraham, you're the God of covenant and faithful promises. Time and time again, you have proven you do just what you said. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast and let my heart learn. When you speak a word, it will come. Faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me. God, from age to age, though the earth may pass away, your word remains the same. Yeah, your history can prove there's nothing you can't do. You're faithful. Steadfast, and let my heart learn when you speak a word. to me.
Amen, amen. Maybe that one was for me. I just praise God because great is his faithfulness, everyone. He is faithful. I don't care where we are in the midst of the storm. He is faithful. Amen and amen for that. I just love the Lord. I'm just so grateful for him being who he is, for loving us the way that he does. It is now time for our sermonic message. This morning's sermonic message comes from Matthew, the 27th chapter, verses 45 through 54. I know it's a lengthy reading, but you couldn't cut it. It had to all be read. So Matthew 27, verses 45 through 54, and it reads, "From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. And about 3 o'clock, Jesus cried with a loud voice, 'Eli, Eli, lima sabachthani?' That is, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?' When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, 'This man is calling for Elijah.' At once, one of them ran and got a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink. But the other said, 'Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him.' Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and the rocks were split. The tombs also were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tomb and entered into the holy city and appeared to many. Now, when the centurion and those with him who were keeping watch over Jesus saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified and said, 'Truly, this man was God's son.'" Amen for the reading and hearing of his word. And let us pray. Oh, Lord, I need you. I pray that your Holy Spirit would touch this message and that this message would be a blessing to these your people in the way that it has already been a blessing unto me. Amen and amen. The subject of this morning's sermonic message, sacrificing when others don't. Sacrificing when others don't. It's fitting on this first Sunday to spend at least some time looking at Jesus's sacrifice. And of course, as we look at that sacrifice, we learn from it. In short, Jesus made the ultimate sacrifice for us. First, he gave up living in paradise for us. Yes, he gave up his lifestyle. Second, he gave up being full deity for us. Yes, he gave up his status. Please note that Jesus was always God, even when he was a man. But Jesus was just as much man as he was God. So he gave up his status of being God only. Third, he gave up his freedoms for us. Yes, he gave up his rights to live how he wanted to live. Fourth, he gave up his life for us. Yes, he gave up his all. Jesus gave. He relinquished. He yielded. He suffered the loss. Yes, he sacrificed. Today's message is important for many reasons. I mean, Jesus is dying on the cross for our sins is major. And as Christians, we understand that although he died, he did not stay dead. I want to repeat that because it is important that no one gets this wrong. Indeed, Jesus died, but he didn't stay dead. He rose and continues to live right now. That's the miracle of Christianity. Jesus rose from the dead. Now, we understand that Jesus' sacrifice is unique and cannot be duplicated. And nevertheless, in this life, we can and should sacrifice. And let me just repeat that. In this life, we can and should sacrifice. And this sacrifice should benefit others as well as ourselves. Here's what I mean. For the most part, we have no problem sacrificing for ourselves and doing whatever it takes to accomplish our goals and objectives. But when it comes to benefiting others, we have preset limits of what we're willing to sacrifice. The thought of having these preset limits, however, is counterintuitive, because the meaning of sacrifice is to voluntarily give up something that helps us to reach some sort of end. It's the manner by which we accomplish what we've set out to accomplish. If giving up the something will allow us to reach the end, then sacrifice would cause us to give it. There's no limit if the thing we're giving up will help us reach our goal. Now, I feel it's important to take a moment and clarify these goals. And looking at Jesus, his only goal was to save us from death and damnation. But of course, in this, Jesus stands alone. And there is nothing that we can give to save ourselves or one another from life without God. So, to understand our need to sacrifice, our goals do not need to be the same as Jesus's. But thank goodness we have the Bible. Because in the Bible, our goals are laid out if we're willing to receive them. I think it's fair this morning to place our goals into two buckets. The first, goals for our lives. The second, goals to help others. As we examine these goals, please keep in mind that Jesus is our perfect example, and we should learn from him. On today, it's all about sacrificing. Now, for this first one, I just need a little bit of leeway. The first sacrifice we see in today's text is a sacrifice of time. Here's what I mean. Jesus left heaven and lived as a man for more than 30 years. 30 years given for us, that was a sacrifice. And it's noteworthy that we benefited from his becoming a man. And it was something that he didn't have to do, yet he did it anyway. That is a sacrifice. Jesus gave us 30 years of his life, and as it turns out, this was his entire life. And ladies and gentlemen, let's examine how much of our lives we're willing to give to God. I didn't even say to others, I said to give to God. I think the best way to describe us as humans is that we hit and miss. Sometimes we live in a manner that is indicative of our giving our lives to God, while at others, we live as we want to live, regardless of the duty that we have to God. Please know, our lives belong to God, and we should live like it. This means that sometimes we just cannot do what we want to do, because many times what we want to do is in opposition to what God would have us to do. So when faced with a decision to say something negative about someone else, let's sacrifice. Yes, we need to give up our entire lives to God. And not just a portion of our lives, but our entire lives. This means that we sacrifice to spend more time in prayer. This means that we sacrifice to attend worship services. This means that we sacrifice to read the Bible. This means that we sacrifice to give our tithes, 10% of all that we receive. This means that we sacrifice to help others. This means that we sacrifice our time. Please stop and consider our typical 24-hour day. How much of that time do we sacrifice to God? Financially, we're tasked to give 10% of our income. So let's just start there. 10% of 24 hours is 2 hours and 40 minutes. New goal, give God his tenth, 2 hours and 40 minutes per day. I know that the realization that we don't give God even a tenth of our time should hit us like a ton of bricks. Starting today, let's try. Incentive. That word just popped into my mind. Why would we give a sacrifice of our time? Well, we do so first and foremost because Jesus did. It's just that simple. Jesus did. And we are tasked to mirror him in whatever way possible. Since he gave a sacrifice of time, we should too. Even more, our faith causes us to know that when we give unto God, he will give back to us. We reap what we sow. And more directly viewed in today's text, being born was not Jesus' only sacrifice of time. He also sacrificed time hanging on the cross. He hung for hours, yes, hours. And during that time, the whole land was dipped in darkness. Imagine, as Jesus hung, darkness joined him. I know that this one will not feel good to any of us, but as we endeavor to give God a sacrifice of time, darkness will appear. There will be some that speak negatively against us, that we pretend to be so holy, or that we think we're better than others, or that we're going crazy with this religion thing. Yes, dark times. Well, please note that having dark times as we try to live how God would have us to live is not unusual. That's been happening for more than 2,000 years. Instead of seeing such dark times as a negative, view them as a positive. And we've joined the ranks of our Savior. That is a positive. So here we are, given a sacrifice of time, something that we didn't have to do, yet we did it anyway. That's sacrifice. Another sacrifice that we note in today's text is Jesus' sacrifice of tears. And we find two separate instances when Jesus cried out as he hung on the cross. The first, he cried out in agony. Yes, he was suffering. He was being tortured. Yes, he was in anguish. Yes, he was experiencing distress. Yes, he was in pain. And when we think of all that Jesus endured for us, we should love him even more. Mm. And never forget, Jesus was a man. He felt pain just like we do. He felt abandonment just like we do. He wanted to quit just like we do. So know that there is nothing wrong with feeling pain, feeling abandoned, and wanting to quit as we live Christian lives. But what we must pay attention to is Jesus' response. He kept going, and he kept going, and he kept going. And that was something that he didn't have to do, yet he did it anyway. That's sacrifice. And as he kept going, he cried with a loud voice. Yes, he cried. I know that I'm not alone in this, and if nothing else, I join Jesus. During times of darkness and pain, I cry out. We all do. Cry out because it hurts. Hurts physically. Yes, being beaten all night long, that hurt Jesus. Yes, the nails in Jesus' hands and feet, that hurt. Yes, the spear in his side, it hurt. Yes, it hurt. But it also hurts spiritually. Yes, Jesus felt separation from the Father. Yes, Jesus wondered why God turned his back on him. Yes, Jesus felt alone. And ladies and gentlemen, we definitely are no better than Jesus. There are times in this journey when we will cry because we are hurt physically and spiritually. Seems the spiritual pain is the worst. We feel separated from God. We wonder why God turned his back on us. We feel alone. But please, let's follow Jesus' example. He did not give up. He finished the assignment. We need to do the same. Please, don't give up. I know, oh, I know, that living in God is sometimes hard. So if we must cry out to God, Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani. My God, why have you forsaken me? Now, let me point us to the fact that although he cried out, he didn't get an answer. That fact hit me. None of the gospel writers mentioned that God spoke to Jesus during his time of suffering. But please know, God heard Jesus' cries. And for the good of the world, he stayed quiet. Again, I know that our assignment is not anywhere near Jesus's. But know that as we live in God, there will be times that we will call on him and he will not speak. That fact is easy to understand in theory, but hard, so very hard to accept in action. We must have faith. Although we may not hear God's voice, we must know and believe that he hears us and is answering our prayers. I try to make sure that I don't leave any message without giving us hope. So please know that sometimes God does speak to us when we're going through our trials. And as we're going through, he speaks loudly. And then he comforts us. He guides us. He strengthens us. And let's not get it into our heads that whenever we're going through, God is not going to speak. That's just not true. We merely need to understand that if we don't hear him speak, he is still with us and he is still working. After all, he said he would never leave us or forsake us. On this, we can depend. So go ahead. It's okay. Cry out to God when in distress. Jesus' cry went even farther. Jesus cried again with a loud voice and breathed his last. Now, indeed, when we reach end of life, it's okay to cry to God. But what I want us to walk away with is the fact that Jesus cried more than once over the same situation. Sometimes we get it into our heads that it's wrong for us to cry. No, our crying has nothing to do with our faith. Oh, I need to say that again. Our crying has nothing to do with our faith. It has everything to do with our pain. So sometimes when thinking of that person we've lost, cry. Sometimes when thinking of that job we've lost, cry. Sometimes when thinking of whatever thing we may have treasured being lost, cry. But allow me to issue a caution. It's okay to cry even more than once, but don't allow our crying to stop us from fulfilling God's promise. Again, we're looking to Jesus. In the midst of the cry, he was living out God's purpose. So don't get distracted. Cry and keep living. Cry and keep loving. Cry and keep going. I know that many in here need to hear this on today. And we mustn't allow our pain to stop us. Allow me to repeat that. Oh, please. We mustn't allow our pain to stop us. Finally, this text shows us Jesus' sacrifice of dignity. Yes, how could Jesus command respect as he hung on a cross? All watched as he was beaten, sacrifice of dignity. All watched as he hung, sacrifice of dignity. All watched as he was mocked, sacrifice of dignity. All watched as he died, sacrifice of dignity. This was something that he didn't have to do, yet he did it anyway. That's sacrifice. Assuredly, Jesus could have come down from the cross, but instead, he sacrificed. I know that sacrificing our dignity doesn't feel good, but we must follow Jesus' example. Caveat, we are sacrificing our dignity for the cause of Christ, and not because we're living unholy, not because we're succumbing to our earthly desires, not because we're disobedient, but because of the cause of Christ. Yes, we may lose our dignity. I can't speak for others, but for me, biting my tongue when I'm insulted is difficult. I consider allowing people to get away with talking down to me as a sacrifice. And I would even say that in my mind, in those instances, I feel and suffer a loss of dignity. And that's all of us. We all have that thing that when we allow it to occur, causes us to suffer a loss of dignity. As we live in Christ, as we offer a sacrifice of time, as we offer a sacrifice of tears, as all around us goes dark, we will from time to time sacrifice our dignity. And no one ever said that living in Christ or following his example would be easy, but we are equipped. Allow me to say that again. We are equipped. We can, we should, we must sacrifice as we live this Christian life. And the sacrifice we take will take some of our time. And the sacrifice will cause us to cry some tears. And the sacrifice will cause us to lose some dignity. But the gain is far greater. We gain a life filled with the favor of God. We gain a life filled with righteousness and live just that way. We gain a life in the ever and forever after. Yes, our gain is far greater. And let's not concern ourselves that it seems as if we're the only people that are endeavoring to follow Jesus' example and to live for God. God always has a remnant unto himself. There are always some that are honoring God with their lives. But in this world, we most often see those that are ungodly. In spite of what we see, keep going and going and going and going. In spite of what we feel, just keep going. In spite of what we hear, keep going. In spite of it all, keep sacrificing when others don't. Amen. Amen. I praise God for Jesus on this morning. Really quickly, I'm offering Jesus to any who do not know him. Jesus is the Son of God. He died on the cross and he rose again from the dead. If you confess that and believe it, you are saved. Please reach out to me that I might be able to share Jesus and First Baptist Church of Tarentum with you more. Amen and amen. It is now time for us to proceed into our communion service. So a couple of things are getting ready to happen. As we sing our closing musical selection, there will be trays passed in the sanctuary to collect our fellowship offering. Please understand that First Baptist Tarentum collects an offering on the first Sunday of each month that we use to be a blessing to people. And I can attest that this money is not put into the general fund. This money is earmarked and given freely to those who are in need. So as the trays pass, feel free to give. Those of you at home, you can just click tithe.lee.com and click fellowship offering. And also, our communion will be passed during this song. So please take your communion cups and prepare yourself. Those of you at home, grab your tea and crumpets that you might be able to participate in the communion service with us. Amen and amen.
Your name stands above them all, and the
Thank you all for being with us today for our worship service. Amen. It is now time for our communion service. On the same night that he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread, and this was at the Passover meal with his best friends. He was sharing a meal, and it was during that meal that he took the bread. And he blessed it. He prayed over it. And he said to his disciples, "This is my body that's being given for you." They had no idea what he was talking about. But he told them, he said, "As often as you eat this bread, I need you to do that in remembrance of me." Just a quick word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your son, Jesus. We thank you for his body. We thank you for all that he gave for us. And our prayer is that we would never forget his sacrifice, never forget his pain, his suffering, the way that he cried on that cross, and that he did it all for us. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Take and eat of the bread. In the same manner that he took the bread, he took the cup after they had eaten. And he said to his disciples, "This cup, this is my blood that is being given for you." And he said, "It creates between you and I a new covenant, a new agreement that, yes, I'm going to die for you, but you're going to live for me. Amen. We praise God for the blood. A quick word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for the blood of Jesus. We thank you for his ultimate sacrifice, for the blood that ran down his side, the blood that cleanses us, the blood that keeps us, the blood that causes us to be able to be in right relationship with you. We say thank you. In your name, Jesus, amen. Take and drink. As often as we eat of this bread and we drink of this cup, we do show forth the Lord's death and resurrection until he comes again. Amen. 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 Stand up with me. We all are excited over the Steelers winning last week. The Lions won last week, so I'm a happy camper. We're not going to talk about the Pirates because we're just not going to do it. So amen. Amen. You know that on First Sundays, we do not do a benediction. So we are going to sing, and then I'm going to say something so y'all can go home happy. Go ahead, Craig. The fellowship of kindred minds is like to that above. Amen. I invite you all to go out into this world that seems to have been turned upside down and do your part to turn it right side up. Amen. And amen. Have a blessed, blessed, and blessed day.
Yeah. Let's do it one more time. Come on, open your mouth and say, I need you.
I need you.
Let me hear you. You